it's a pleasure to be back. I congratulate you for this workshop or special day dedicated to Maria Petrou. Her reputation preceded her because I remember Mihaly Strinsis talking about her before I had a chance to meet her. I met her when she became the director of ITI, and what I can say is, apart from the fact that we had an excellent relationship and collaboration over the few years that she was with us, I can remember her approach to doing business, very calm, very positive, and yet firm, I would say. She had a way of pushing her ideas, her opinion on making things happen. I believe that as a director, she left her mark on ITI. She insisted on excellence, on scientific excellence, and this is something that has been a trademark for ITI. We're all very, very glad that her legacy continues. I was disappointed that I missed the first part of today's proceedings, especially the last talk by Stavros Theodoridis. I was planning to be here, but you managed to finish earlier than the scheduled time, which is quite unusual for conferences and proceedings. So, I just want to finish by saying that I'm confident that the course that ITI has drawn in the map of ICT, the map of research and technology in Greece, will continue to be broad and stellar. As rector of Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, as somebody who has worked closely with CERTH and ITI, somebody who knows very well very well the importance of collaborations in the research map, I will continue to support all the activities that will bring us, that may bring us closer together. As chair of the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering in the past, I had seen troves of our graduates coming or passing through ITI before they moved to other endeavors in or outside the country. And I believe that, I know that CERTH is an excellent employer for young scientists and researchers. So the university will continue to supply you with excellent scientists. You will continue to provide them good positions and experience. And we will continue to collaborate on research program projects and other activities. Again, Maria Petrou will be missed, and all those of us who have had the chance to know her will always remember her. Thanks.
Now we continue with our second sessions. The first session will be with collaborators of Maria outside the IDI, and the last session will be from collaborators of Maria from within IDI, which to an extent, actually they continue the work that she started here at Mention. But first we will start with Dr. Palma Blonda from Siena in Italy, and she's going to present the work in biosocial arm of the project, which was very relevant to the main area of Maria, remote sensing.
First of all, I would like to thank you, the organizers, the organizer of this day, of this special day for me. And I'd like to talk about the collaboration with Maria and her group on remote sensing applications for environmental monitoring. I met Maria in late 19 at IGAR's IT Pluini conference on remote sensing and geoscience, and we first participated in fifth framework program project dealing with early warning of landslides from optical and cell data. And this, what I'm presenting today, is the last project I had the honor to lead with the help of Maria and his great experience. Not only in remote sensing, but also in pattern recognition, as I will explain you. This project was funded within the space FP7 theme, third call, and it deals with the pre-operational validation of GMS services and products, where GMS, now named Copernicus, is the most ambitious Earth observation program to support environmental monitoring in Europe. The main objective of this program is to provide the global Earth observation system of systems, and within this system of systems, different application domain will be monitored. Weather, water, biodiversity, ecosystem, agriculture, climate, energy, health, and disasters. The main objective of this call was to stimulate the development of Copernicus services, not only core services, and explain what does it mean, but only downstream services. Core services are provided by Copernicus within previous project, as a result of previous project, to support end users with value-added products, such as land cover maps, change maps, vegetation index. And the downstream services are additional, specifically oriented to applications like biodiversity. Let me cite habitat mapping. These were not provided before, and mainly at very high resolution. In the previous project with Maria, we worked with the medium resolution data, Landsat data, just to make an example. In this work, we are dealing with land cover classification and habitat classification, dealing with very high resolution data from Worldview2, Worldview3, QuickBird, Iconos, recent sensors. The project started at the end of November 2010, and it was closed last year in November 2013. Three-year project, looking at the future application of the application of also future sensors in biodiversity and ecosystem monitoring. This is a constellation of Sentinel sensors. This is a European constellation composed by radar and optical sensors that will be launched in next few years. Sentinel-1 is already operating. It is a radar sensor. But this sensor will provide very frequent high resolution data. That means every 3 days it will be possible to have an image at 10 or 20 meters of resolution, depending on the sensors. So in this presentation, first of all, I try to provide a brief introduction of the problem and the main user needs. This is an application-oriented project, so as we heard this morning, with Maria, we worked in collaboration with the SMEs because the main purpose of such project is to provide support, scientific support to decision makers in a different application domain. I will introduce the issues that we have to deal when we apply remote sensing techniques to habitat and biodiversity monitoring, which is the application field of this project, and the proposed solutions from our project, including some details of the Earth observation system for habitat monitoring designed and implemented by the consortium, and the main achievements with focus on the exploitation of the results of a biosource in future projects and in applications and application environments. The problem is mainly related to biodiversity loss, which is mainly driven not only by climatic but anthropogenic changes, induced changes, which affect the status, the conservation status of ecosystem and of ecosystem services. There are the Habitat and Birds Directive here in Europe that try to implement the Convention of Biological Diversity adopted by several countries, and the strategic plan for biodiversity monitoring and halting biodiversity habitat loss. The states, according to this habitat directive, are committed to regularly report on the status and trends of biodiversity, ecosystem, and their service, and just to understand how important it is to analyze long-time series of EO data and to extract the changes in order to identify trends in drivers of biodiversity loss. I'm just reporting recent notes from the International Union for Conservation of Nature, which explain or which says that Ebola outbreak directly links with biodiversity loss and human health. And one of, by zooming the text, we identify again the need to detect land use changes and habitat changes, which are threatening the biodiversity, ecosystem, and then human well-being. According to the Habitat Directive, we have the management authorities of Natura 2000 sites, which is a network of protected areas in Europe. We need to report, they need to report on the range of habitats as proxies of biodiversity, on the extension and changes in extension fragmentation of habitat, on the structure and functions of habitats, as well as on pressures and threats. But what the management authorities need for regional and local decision making is not only scientific support, but the availability of open access data, of standardized cost-effective monitoring techniques, and mainly what they ask are multi-scale data sources with a focus on mapping made at 1 to 5,000 or finer scale. And they are looking for long-term data series to monitor changes and detect trends. What generally, traditionally is done for habitat monitoring is just to carry out infield campaigns, which are very costly, or generally they use visual interpretation of aerial orthophoto to extract land cover and use information, but land cover and use is not sufficient to provide habitat information because habitats are more linked to species, to communities and biotopes. So expert knowledge from a botanist and an ecologist is generally required and implicitly adopted, used when by visual interpretation ecologists start from orthophoto, provide a land cover maps and then try to delineate habitat maps. What we tried to do in our project was to support with long-term series analysis of remote sensing data and mainly very high resolution data because we have the availability of multi-temporal information and different resolution that can be used to follow plant phenology, to explain the ecological process, to monitor ecological processes evolution. And we have also aerial sensors that can complement optical and radar satellites with data concerning plant aid measurements, because plant aid measurements are very important for discriminating an input land cover class into different habitat classes. Great interest on the application remote sensing data for habitat monitoring is revealed by the first technical report of CBD dated 2007. This is the last report, 2014. This is one of the most recent symposium on the application of remote sensing data for conservation purposes. This is just an example of what very high resolution multi-temporal images can provide. This is in this area. This was a biosourced site in Murgalda, southern part of Italy. There are forest coniferous forests detected in a different season, and in light green here you have deciduous forest. So by using the multi-temporal information, you can compensate the lack of spectral band availability in the infrared areas of the electromagnetic spectrum. So the working objective, I do not like to provide you a lot of details because they are very specific to this project, but we tried to develop the new data processing techniques able to analyze very high resolution data mainly, and to develop an ecological modeling framework at both habitat and landscape level in order to provide to end users what they need at the scale that they require. And we tried also to generalize the techniques to non-European sites. Very important was the contribution of the CERTH in this project for both habitat modeling and also for the implementation of the classification rules, and mainly for their falsification and to deal with the uncertainties related to data processing. So in order to develop such kind of system, we had to integrate the expertise of different domain from ecologists, botanists, as well as computer scientists, and four SMEs participated to our project. 16 partners for a 3-year project, €2.5 million of euro. And okay, when we started to work, we immediately realized that there are some important issues for habitat monitoring from space, because land cover domain and habitat and biodiversity domain are different domains, so we need to fill the gaps between these two different domains. So we started by analyzing the different taxonomy, because we had to produce land cover and habitat maps not only for European side, but also outside Europe, in Brazil and in India. We need to train a classification system dealing with a high dimensional data, and we would like to not use the ground truth data for training the system because infill campaigns, as I told you previously, are very costly, and sometimes you cannot go in specific sites. We had as a test site a tiger reserve in India, and people had problem in getting ground truth for validation, just for validation, because of the tiger. Since we are also dealing with very high resolution data, we had to adopt not pixel-based but object-based techniques. So we had to use some semantic in order to translate the coherent use to habitats, and as I told you, to fill the gaps within the gaps between these different application domains, and also to define what habitat conservation status means, which kind of indicators, how can we operationalize the quantification of such indicators. So within this project, we had both a module devoted to EODHaM processing, but another big VP was devoted to modeling and all the models of all work packages of our system were well integrated in a collaborative way. We learned a lot from botanists and vice versa, let me say. This is the scheme of the system I implemented. It is a modular system, multi-modular system, which is based on the integration of earth observation data, but also in-situ data, where in-situ data were used only for translating land cover and use to habitat maps, but not for training the system. And the prior spectral knowledge from remote sensing expert was used in the first stage to segment the images, whereas the description of land cover and habitat classes through ontologies was used in order to develop the second modules, which is based on the application of class-specific context-sensitive features to provide land cover maps. And then, again, knowledge was used in the third stage module, which provided habitat classes in different taxonomy, Annex 1 first, because Annex 1 is adopted by the European directive, UNIS, which seems to be the future taxonomy that will be applied, since it includes not only natural habitat but also artificial classes, and general habitat category maps, which is a new taxonomy introduced by Altera in a previous project, and which can be applied outside of Europe also, where Annex 1, UNIS, Corinne Land Cover are not used, but where they use a classification taxonomy mainly related or describing life forms. So these are the sites, the study sites of our project, distributed in Northern Europe, Southern Europe, but also, as I told you, in Brazil and India. And what about the taxonomies? We had to work all together in order to find the best taxonomy that can, first of all, harmonize the different land cover taxonomies used in Europe and outside Europe, and in order to provide the successive translation, the subsequent, translation to habitats. And this was the taxonomy provided by the FAO, the Food and Agriculture Organization, and named land cover classification system. The general habitat categories is the new habitat categories proposed by Altera. Just to make an example, an example and to show you what we had to understand as computer scientists. This is an example. Salt marshes is a class in marine taxonomy. It can be expressed as just one code, but it can provide, it can be described in FAUL CCS by different codes that are able to describe the different habitats belonging to the same land cover. The land cover is mainly related to herbaceous classes, but depending on their location, depending on other specific local characteristics, can provide, as you can see, different habitat. And which is the main advantage of FAUL CCS, that you can integrate, you have a framework already available, you know, useful to integrate this additional local site information, such as soil, subsurface, aspect, water quality, useful to further discriminate habitats belonging to the same land cover class. So this is the scheme, the hierarchical scheme used for classification and that we implemented. You can find any detail on our website. And so, as I told you, once the taxonomy was selected, was identified, we used our preliminary spectral knowledge to identify the spectral indices and to separate the main land cover classes according to the FAUL CCS scheme hierarchy. And then we introduced both temporal and context-sensitive features in order to describe and to identify subset classes belonging to the same main categories. Vegetation is composed by a lot of classes. And in the EODHaM stage, we used the modeling at habitat level and at landscape level in order to provide habitats, but also useful indicators for conservation managers. But as I told you, we use ontologies in order to represent such botanists, ecologists, and remote sensing expert knowledge. But as you know, the taxonomic name of a class is not sufficient to describe completely the complexity of such class, mainly at very high resolution data. This is Nori Grotis. Also, this is another body gross. You are familiar with this class, as you can see. You can detect at very high resolution data the grass and the soil that compose the background of this class. And the core of the class is made by the olive crowns. So we used ontologies in order to represent for natural and artificial classes the phenology, the information related to the phenology, that means the season of the month where the vegetation had a dense coverage and so on. This is for Italy, this is for Greece. The water coverage is expressed, so the rule is expressed by the ecologist, the botanist of the area, but also we use agricultural practices in order to separate at 4 months cultivated areas from natural pastures. So we implemented, we mapped this knowledge in the hierarchy provided by the LCCS. So in the first stage, and spectral knowledge was used. In the second stage, context-sensitive and phenological, that means temporal knowledge, was adopted. This is an example. This is a very high-resolution image collected in May for Murcia Alta site. This is the October image, and you can see the different color of the fields related to agricultural practices. This is the image acquired in January and in July. We increased the number of images because of the spectral separability of these glasses. Two images were not enough, so we need to use these images also to integrate the expert knowledge provided by different field of expertise. These are some of the vegetation indices used in order to automatically segment the image and separate and identify macro classes that are natural classes, vegetated terrestrial classes, agricultural, terrestrial, aquatic, cultivated or natural. So these are the output of an object-oriented approach. Here you can see the classification where all small objects detected in an image are represented. You can see within this area, which is a pasture areas, the different trees or shrubs within included in this area. This information layer is useful for the ecologists and the botanists in order for this area to deal with the encroachment of a pasture which affect the conservation status of species in natural grasslands. This is the layer provided as large objects layers where there were applied some rules in order to provide a more homogeneous and completely different information to end users. So this work started with end users' requirements, where end users were scientists, management authorities, and we tried to provide them layers useful for their decision making. This is another area. You can see within this area different kind of forest, and again in red, single trees. This is a zoom on the example provided in the previous slide on grassland encroachment. Here there are the small, a zoom on the small object and the large object output map, and these are the original input images. Something about validation. The problem in the application of remote sensing data regularly in the management chain of Natura 2000 areas is mainly related to the fact that some maps, some products are provided without any measurement of accuracy or error. So in this case, the accuracy was not so high, but it was considered useful by end users just because we analyzed the whole area without training data. Here are reported the overall accuracy, the percentage of error, and this is a graph reporting the specific glass user's accuracy. So this is a list of downstream products in the framework of Copernicus that you can extract from the maps or directly from the images in terms of spectral indices which are used for landscape modeling in future steps. Just an example, I'm closing the presentation. These are the Vancouver maps obtained on different areas. Just to see that the system is a pre-operational system. What does it mean, pre-operation? We need to generalize the setting of some parameters, and this can be done by analyzing several images. Last stage, translation from Vancouver and user to habitats. A lot of work, interdisciplinary work, needed to understand the expert background of ecologists and to try to make and to engineerize this mapping, which is not a lookup table only, but includes ecological concepts. And we were able to provide this Annex 1 Habitats for Habitat Directive by integrating in two ways, by integrating environmental attributes, lithology, water salinity, and so on, as I already showed in some previous slide, or why all? Because these data are not available, mainly in Mediterranean areas, or at least are not provided by centralized archive. So it is very difficult to find such data, and the data to the appropriate scale. So another way is, when possible, to adopt a spatial relation and temporal relation. This was done in coastal wetlands, as I will show you, and the last part was, again, to provide a mapping from Lenkover and use glasses in our CCS taxonomy to general habitat categories. So we have provided an operative framework for different translations. This is the first example. This is a site. It is a site in a coastal wetland. These are the GIS strata used and integrated according to the botanist expertise. And this is the very high resolution map obtained, both in by considering Annex 1 and future UNIS taxonomy. And for the same site, even if for this site environmental attributes are available, we tried also a different way. We tried to verify the generalization and the effectiveness of these pattern zonation rules provided by the botanists, according to which the same Lenkover expressed in according to LCCS is aquatic vegetation herbaceous forms annual. This Lenkover can provide these two, at least in this area, these two different habitats here in red, 1310 and 3170. This is Annex 1 nomenclature, belonging to the same Lenkover category, but 1310 is adjacent to the lagoon. And again, a different example of a terrestrial vegetation class. And again, one of the two habitats it can provide is adjacent to the sea. So you have to organize a hierarchy of your rule and then to apply the rule. Last page, LCCS 2G. And we have published a paper. I will show you the list of this paper. And the last stage, last difficulties for LCCS 2G AC translation, since this translation again includes one to many or many to many relationship, and this is the work done here at CERTH. We, to solve these ambiguities, we integrated LIDAR data that solved some problem related, some ambiguities related to plant aids, but we adopted also entropy features, because when you do not have LIDAR data, costly, they are collected from aerial campaigns, you can use, or we try to use, a texture information to provide at least two range of plant aids. This is the list of rules implemented. This is the scheme. Okay, you can find any detail on our webpage. This is the final map for the Sicilia site, for Lago Salso site. These are only the papers published on this mapping between Lenkover and use and the different habitats taxonomies. Once you have Lenkover maps or habitat maps detected at a different time, you can detect the changes in a supervised or unsupervised way. And the FAO-LCCS taxonomy, in order to detect pressures and trends to be used in scenario analysis. This is the post-specification comparison is well can be carried out very easily when Thor CCS is adopted, because we can just compare each code provided in the label of our linkover classes. The system and the service to end users will be provided by an SMEs involved in our project, Planetech, that will try to adapt and generalize the setting of the system to different sites. They evaluated also the cost of the service. We, just before my conclusion, we also provided at the end of the project some recommendation for biodiversity monitoring to both member states, but also to Copernicus for the acquisition, the regular acquisition of a very high resolution data on Natura 2000 sites, and also to collect infield data for validation purposes, not only according to Corinne taxonomy, which is most used taxonomy in Europe, but also according to this FAO SCS taxonomy. So these are the achievements, but let me spend the last comment on the exploitation of the system. The system has been already proposed in three horizon, two-stage proposal within a call devoted to societal challenges, call SC56204, dealing with the relationship between biodiversity loss and the degradation of ecosystem status and services. And another call we are participating, Biosource is proposed in two competitive proposals for the regular mapping of protected areas from space. And it is already exploited in an ongoing FP7 project, COBWEB, which uses citizen scientist measurements, citizen science observatories, in order to validate the maps produced by our system. So I think that these achievements are very encouraging to continue to contribute with the remote sensing data to the monitoring of ecosystem and ecosystem services. And just to conclude, I would like to thank all the women involved in this very challenging project. Thank you. They are trying to adapt it to other sites, maybe within other projects like COBWEB, okay? Because they started to use our software, which is written in Python. So mainly all the modules, as you have seen, the system is a multi-modular system. So some modules were originated directly in the Python source. Other modules were firstly implemented by using commercial software such as Incognition or Envy software, and then they were translated, or they are being translated in Python. So Planetech should update the release of BioSOS as soon as all modules will be ready in their final form.
Okay, very nice, thank you very much.
And the next reservation comes